John Deere is one of the classic success stories of the tractor industry. Its origins go back more than 150 years to a small blacksmith shop in Grand Detour, Illinois, and now it is the world's most successful farm equipment manufacturer. We're at the international headquarters of the Deere organization at Moline, Illinois, where the company archives are kept. They also have a showroom display of John Deere memorabilia and equipment old and new. The display is open to the public and it attracts thousands of visitors every year. One of the exhibits they come to see is a replica of the 1892 tractor built by John Froelich, the earliest ancestor of all John Deere tractors. The replica was built in 1937 to feature in a film, and we've asked Ralph Hughes to tell us about it. Ralph is a former Deere & Company executive, and he is also one of the leading authorities on the company history, including the early Froelich period. Well, let's start with Froelich the man. Who is he?
Well, his parents came to the United States from Germany and settled in northeastern Iowa, and opened a store at a crossroad of a railroad track and a highway, and that became Froelich Station. And then when they took on the post office there, it became the town of Froelich, Iowa. And John Froelich was the son, and he got into a variety of businesses. He had an elevator, he had a well drilling crew, and he also had a big thrashing crew. And the problem with the thrashing crew, he used to load them on trains and take them up in South Dakota, and he used a steam engine as his power source and a thrashing machine, and he had a boxcar converted into living accommodations for his crew. But he kept running into the problem that the steam engine was too heavy to go across a lot of the rural bridges. And so he always thought there was a better way, and about that time he became aware of the gasoline engine and thought, well, gosh, if I could put a gasoline engine on a steam tractor, why, it would be a lighter weight. And when he came up with his with the Froelich traction engine, it had the same power as a steam engine, but it was half the weight. One of the most significant things about this traction engine was it had the ability of going both forward and backward under its own power. And up to that time, no other tractor or vehicle could do that. Even a steam engine, you had to actually stop the engine and restart the flywheel in the opposite direction to back it up. And if you think about hooking up a belt to a thrashing machine, right, that became very cumbersome. And one of the big significant things was this didn't require a second operator, didn't require a team of horses to haul water, and didn't require fuel. You didn't have to get here early to power it up, get the steam up. When you started the traction engine, you had power immediately.
Right. And what happened to that tractor? Did it go on working?
Well, after that tractor was so successful, Froelich was invited to come to Waterloo, Iowa, and meet with some business people with the idea of manufacturing that tractor. And the agreement was reached, and they started a company there, which is called the Waterloo Traction Engine Company. And they actually dismantled his original tractor and used that engine to run the machinery in the factory to build the next four tractors that they manufactured. And they found out very shortly that they couldn't profitably build traction engines. They need another product line, and so they started building stationary engines. And there was a big demand for stationary engines at that time. And they did that for a couple of years, and eventually Froelich left the company that he started or helped start. And he attempted to start some other engines companies on his own, and he eventually ended up in St. Paul, where he had a variety of interest in different kinds of manufacturing companies.
And the Waterloo Company, they just went on manufacturing engines and presumably for an expanding market.
That's right, but they always had in the back of their minds to get into the traction engine business, and eventually they built up enough expertise that they built the Waterloo Boy traction engine. It started out as a portable stationary engine. Thinking back on it, I think actually the stationary engines were called Waterloo Boy engines.
Oh, right, before the tractors came out. Yeah.
And so, as you know, they started out with bigger engines and kept getting smaller and smaller because the requirement in the farm was for engines to run wells, to run washing machines, for generators and things like that.
So it was a big market.
Right.
And then they got involved with tractors. And when did they start making tractors seriously?
They started making tractors around 1912, and Deere and Company bought then the factory in 1918.
Do we know what Deere paid for the company?
Yes, there's a check on the wall over here for $2,100,000.
I hope it was cashed at the time.
And I should make it such a good investment.
Right, yes, definitely.
The fuel system looks quite complicated, Ralph. Can you run through, tell us how it works?
Well, yes, it really is not complicated. It's a very simple system. This was the main or reserve tank. The operator had to pump fuel from this tank up into this tank here because it had no fuel pump on the engine. The fuel went into the engine by gravity feed. The operator would actually turn the fuel on here and control the speed of the engine with this throttle.
And then you've got the steering system here, which that does look quite simple, doesn't it?
Well, one of the things that they called a strong feature of this tractor, if you remember the steam locomotive, the driver was typically in back behind the tank and everything and couldn't see where he was going very well. He had to lean out like on a train. In this tractor, he was able to stand in front and see where he was going. Of course, it took a lot of manpower to steer it. But it had a worm and gear steering device and a chain link to the front wheels.
The transmission starts with these exposed gears here, and I've a feeling that might not meet the safety requirements today, Rob.
I'm sure it wouldn't. When they built this replica, they tried to be very faithful to the original design, and this is the way tractors were built in those days, and they were very much open. The gears were open when you get to them. You could lubricate them easily.
They had some very good photographs to work from, didn't they, of the original tractor?
Well, they had a few photographs, but they did have some original drawings.
Oh, they had the drawings as well. I didn't realize that. And then the final drive is, again, exposed gearing. Now, that looks as though it could conceivably have come from a Waterloo Boy tractor, Ralph.
It probably did. They tried to make this as authentic as possible, but after 45 years, it's doubtful that all the parts remain.
Comfort and convenience for the operator weren't the really strong features in the 1890s, were they, Ralph? But we've got the beginnings here, haven't we?
Right, they weren't totally overlooked. You know, when you drive a tractor a long distance at 2.5 miles an hour, it's very nice to have a large, roomy platform to move around in. The operator could sit on the gasoline tank, and he had a supply of fresh water right at hand.
Well, this is something that you spotted on the early photographs?
That was in one of the early photographs, showed the water supply right here. And it was in a wooden holder that could be wetted down to keep it cool.
Here in the dry and dusty conditions, a driver out in the sun all day would need plenty of water to quench his thirst. From the magnificent grounds of the John Deere headquarters, we're going to the sleepy town of Keystone, Iowa, where Darrell Sint of Sint Implements has a large collection of tractors, including an early Waterloo Boy. The Waterloo Boy was already in production at the time John Deere took over the company. When we arrived, Darrell's son Derek was trying to start the Waterloo Boy, which at almost 80 years old was being a little bit temperamental. Tell us a bit about this one. Do you know where it was originally delivered to?
It was originally shipped to Bradford, Iowa. The tractor was built on March 28, 1916. It's a 16 model, serial number 2512.
Did it need a lot of restoration when you got it, or was it already restored?
We bought it restored. Right. And by the looks of the tractor, I'd say it was pretty straight before they restored it.
Yeah. The transmission on this one is a single forward speed, I think.
Right. All Model R's had a one speed forward and reverse, and the Model N's had two speeds forward. And also the clutch was a foot clutch on the Model R's, and it went to a hand clutch on the Model N.
So in that respect, they went backwards a little bit, because I would have thought the foot clutch is a lot more handy to use if you've got your hands on the steering wheel and trying to turn it ahead.
Yeah, everybody thought John Deere was way behind with the hand clutch, but we had a foot clutch here, clear back in 1916.
Right, yeah. And what about the engine on this? What is it a little bit temperamental to start? I mean, it didn't fancy starting up this morning.
Yes, it can be. It's a two-cylinder horizontal engine like the later tractors, yeah. But it's the framework and the way it sits on the tractor is totally different.
What was the power output?
This was rated at 1224.
Any idea what the engine speed was at then? I mean, what RPMs did it
have? Top speed was 750. Yes. I think the range was 300 to 750 RPMs.
So it was a fairly leisurely engine.
It's not slow compared to newer stuff.
It was not built for speed.
No, right. That's for sure.
One of the distinctive features of the Waterloo Boy, both the R and the N, is the way the radiator's arranged in line with the length of the tractor. And then you've got this, what looks like a fairly complicated drive system to it. Can you tell us what the driving belts are doing?
Oh, it's fairly simple. Both of the belts are driving off the crankshaft, one to the fan and one to the water pump, which is gravity feeds the water down through the radiator and into the pump, and it pumps it back to the engine. And this drive belt is kind of unique. It is all spliced together in sections, something you don't see very often.
We're back to the engine now, this what became later a very familiar two-cylinder design. Lubrication was quite a complicated business, wasn't it? I mean, they relied heavily on oil caps all over the place that needed screwing down.
Yeah, the oil caps, like on your water pump and your axles, most of the pivot points are probably a daily or more often you had to tighten them up just to force the grease into it. As far as the engine, it had an oil sump, holds about a gallon. Your push rods and the rocker arm valves are all right out in the open, and you'd take an oil can to lubricate up the rocker arms, but other than that it was pretty much all automatic besides the oil cups. This small red tank here holds gasoline, which was used to start the tractor. And then when the engine was warmed up, you switched a valve down here in the carburetor, and the tractor would run on kerosene from the front tank. This lever here controls the spark advance. You would start it in the, or put it in the rear position to start, and then you adjust it for your best power when the tractor's running. The throttle is this lever here. You want to start out at half throttle to try to start the tractor.
You mentioned the difference in the final drive. How did they change it when they came out with the Model N?
Okay, Model R had a small spur gear with this bull gear on the outside. On the Model N, this gear would be reversed. It's almost the same diameter as the rim. And the teeth are pointed in, the drive gear is still about here. And that drives the wheel. I suppose that was a better design.
The steering system on this was a little bit similar to what was used on steam engines quite a while before this was built. Can you explain how the movement was transmitted to the wheels?
Okay, the steering wheel drove down to this bevel gear set up here, which turned this center casting that holds the chain and pushes the chain back and forth, or more or less pulls it which way you want to direct the tractor to go. And this chain, they'll pull the chain back, which would pull the front axle back, and just pivots in the center, and it's got a spring there to take some of the shock out of it.
And the spring also allows you a bit of adjustment, presumably, if you take
to tighten up the chain.
Yeah.
I guess, or if you had to take any of this apart.
Yes, it may not have been the most refined system, but I bet it was tough. In fact, the whole of the tractor is a little bit like the steering system in a way. It's very simple and very rugged. You've got this massive steel girder framework supporting the individual components, the engine, cooling system, fuel tank, and right at the back of the seat. It's you couldn't ask for anything much more simple. Well, we've just moved from a very hot day in Iowa to a very cold day in England, and chugging away in the background you can hear an overtime tractor. Now, you may be wondering what that's got to do with John Deere. We'll have a talk with the owner, James Coward, and see what he's got to say about it. So what's the overtime tractor got to do with Waterloo Boy, James?
Well, the overtime tractor was imported by a firm in London and painted in the colours it is for the English and European market.
So they changed from the familiar yellow and green, or green and yellow rather?
Yes, to the green, orange and grey for some reason. Possibly the name Waterloo Boy didn't mean too much to the English market, and over time during the First War, when there was a big press on for food, was an apt name for them.
Do you know what year this one is?
It's around about 1917.
And apart from the change in colour, it's basically
the same tractor, yes.
An early Waterloo boy.
Yes, yes. Single speed tractor.
And it'd be a Model R then?
Yes.
Yeah. And do you know much about the history of this particular tractor?
This tractor was imported by myself in about 1978 from Northern Ireland.
So that's interesting, because Northern Ireland is where Harry Ferguson set himself up as a distributor for the Overtime, isn't it?
Yes, there's a strong possibility that this tractor could have been one that Harry Ferguson sold or demonstrated in Northern Ireland.
And probably demonstrated, because he was very keen on getting out and getting mud on his boots,
yes,
and doing the job,
yes,
himself. And it was this sort of tractor, in fact the Overtime, that started Ferguson off on his research and development to produce the three-point linkage as we know it today.
Yes, yes.
You obviously did a pretty good reconstruction job,
yes,
on it, because I believe when you got it, it didn't quite look like that.
It was a long job. It was very rough. It took me about 2 years to do it. The chassis was completely rotted through. It was devoid of all of its tin work. The engine came in pieces.
Well, it literally came in on
literally
a couple of pallets,
came in pieces on pallets.
Yeah. Well, I won't ask you how many hours it took, but it does you a lot of credit anyway. It looks great and it sounds great. From James Coward's Overtime, restored to showroom condition, we moved back to a small town called Grundy Center near Waterloo, Iowa, where the Two Cylinder Club has its headquarters. And that's where I met Jack Cherry and Scott Zaborowski. The Model D was the first two-cylinder tractor to carry the John Deere name. This is an early example, and it's owned by Scott Zaborowski, who is the administrative director of the Two Cylinder Club. Scott, what are the features that show that this is an early example of the Model D?
Well, the most distinctive feature, Mike, is the spoke flywheel. On the early tractors, the first 880 of the spoke flywheel Ds, the flywheel diameter was 26 inches. In 1925, at serial number 31,278, it was reduced to 24 inches. The reason it was reduced to 24 inches was that there was a little bit of clearance problem between the steering rod and the flywheel itself during some rough terrain maneuvers in the fields. In 1925, when they reduced the flywheel diameter, they also added a universal joint and made the steering rod two-piece. You notice here, this one is a straight shot right down to the front axle. Another distinctive feature is that this design, this main case of the early tractors, did not allow for a PTO on the left-hand side, the power takeoff. That also changed with the reduction of the size of the flywheel. They also made it capable of taking the power takeoff unit.
Altering the diameter of the flywheel must have affected the performance of the engine in some way. Did they compensate for that?
Not that we're aware of, but yes, in governor recovery, it should have enhanced the quicker governor recovery.
But they didn't alter the weight of the flywheel?
No, the weight stayed the same. Actually, the design, it even bears the same part number, the 26-inch flywheel, the 24-inch spoke flywheel, and then the later dished flywheel that we're all familiar with, all bear the D33R part number. The earliest of the spoke flywheel Ds, the first 50, in the spokes of the steering wheel itself, had four individual holes. In 1924, in regular production, they reduced the number of holes to three. With the reduction of the flywheel to 24 inches, we reduced the number of holes in the steering wheel rim, or steering wheel spokes, to two. And by the end of production, when the spoke flywheels were finally gone into the middle of the 1926 year, there were no holes left in the steering wheel. Another feature of the early Model Ds is the fact that since this tractor was still a Waterloo gasoline engine product, but at that time Waterloo Gasoline Engine Company was owned by John Deere, it still bears the Waterloo name on the transmission cover.
The lug design on this D is quite a bit different to later tractors like the C and the GPs. Is this original?
Yes, this is a reproduction of the original lugs. This style we call a flat pack lug was in production into the 1927 year when we saw the change to the more traditional or the more widely known lug. It is really a peculiarity of the model, the early model Ds. Another unusual feature is the hubcap. On the earliest of the model Ds, this is the style of hubcap that they had. There was a little bit of a problem with keeping the hub tight, and so a design change was added about 1926. This is a rare and unusual cap to find if one is looking for it.
Presumably there would be very few tractors left with the original ladder radiator sides.
Yes, it's an unusual feature. We estimate that no more than 65 tractors were built with the ladder radiator sides. It is a pretty rare option to see it exist today. In 1924, the production changes that were made to the tractor incorporated the removal of that ladder radiator side. The air intake on this tractor denotes that this is an actual 1924 tractor in the fact that it has a peaked or stove pipe top on the air intake. 1925 tractors were changed to a mushroom style topper, and the earlier tractors, the first 50 or the 1923 models, had a air intake which was underneath the hood. It was a four louvered arrangement which had a fruit or mason jar at the bottom to collect the dirt. This front axle support on the early tractors is quite different than later production. In 1923 and 1924 tractors, this recessed cavity was developed for tractors being able to push farm wagons around with it. In 1925, this recess was removed and the actual casting was changed to a flat surface here, and by the 1926 or late production, a little stub tongue was added to it in helping of transporting wagons.
The power output of the early Model Ds was 15 horsepower on the drawbar and about 27 on the belt pulley. We will return to the two-cylinder club later after hanging up our boots and paying a visit to Fred Cobbler in Ottumwa, Iowa, where we talk about his Streeter D. Now, Fred, why Streeter D?
Well, the word Streeter is used mainly because these was never made on assembly line in the factory. They were made after the assembly line was tore down of the Model D. And you probably already know that the Model D was the longest production tractor ever made in the history of any farm equipment dealer in the whole world.
Yeah. So when was this tractor made?
Well, this tractor was made after, as I just previously said, after the assembly line was shut down, and actually was made in 1953. Now, that doesn't mean that all 53s are Streeters. To come about on this, there was a dealer in Arkansas, a John Deere dealer, who wanted more Ds to sell. Sales had slowed down all over the United States, but he still wanted them. So Deere evaluated the situation, and I was told by them that they decided they had enough parts and inventory that they would set up and build these tractors outside of the building, in the street or in the alley right beside, and that they would consume up those parts and for a total of 94 of them that was built. Half of those 94 ended up going to Europe, and the other half stayed in the United States.
So this is really a very uncommon tractor indeed.
This is a very, very unusual tractor as far as the serial number is concerned, and called a Streeter. Model-wise and appearance-wise, it's generally almost the same as most style Ds.
Yeah, right. So this is one of the very last of the Model D production tractors, and right next door to it, we've got one of the very early ones as well. That one, what year was that produced, Fred?
And that model over there is a 1924, called a Spoker D, that's with a 26-inch flywheel.
So that was one of the really early ones.
Yes, there's 50 made in 1923 prior to this.
So we got pretty well 30 years of D production in these two tractors.
What basically we got here is the first four-year production, and we got the last year production, and we think that's real unique. I don't know of another place you can go and see both of them sitting side by side.
From the rare sight of the first and the last versions of the Model D, we chose a rainy day in one of the wettest summers for years to go to the two-cylinder club headquarters at Grundy Center. The club has an enthusiastic membership throughout North America and in many overseas countries as well, and Jack Cherry is the editor of the club magazine. How did it start, Jack?
Actually, the club itself was started in North Dakota by a group of individuals who were interested in being able to further their collection in a parts swapping theme. And a fellow from Minot, Leroy Klein, started a small swap sheet type of a newsletter, and over a period from about 1980 until 85, give or take some figures, it averaged about 1,000 people had gotten involved in what he had called the two-cylinder club. He had indicated that he would like to get out from under it because his facilities were somewhat limited. He was doing it off of a copy machine and so on. And he had full-time work and did not have a lot of historical material. So we worked with Leroy, Dave Trumbauer, and myself for 6 months, maybe 8 months, to arrive at an agreement to transfer it to Waterloo, where we had the resources to be able to provide technical information. And then in 1988, we upgraded our capabilities, got out of the typewriter end of it, and got into the typesetting, the desktop publishing computers, and created a magazine from it.
What happened to membership over this period? I mean, it's grown very quickly.
I can give you a pretty good idea of that. Yeah, I remember the figures when we went into the 1987 Expo, which was to celebrate the 150th anniversary of John Deere at Waterloo. At that time, there was 2,700 members in July of 1987. Now there is over 25,000. The membership vacillates up and down a bit, about 1,000 or so.
It's much, much bigger than any of the other single make organizations.
Yeah, I believe that's, correct.
Yeah. Why has it been so successful?
I think that the success of the club is reflected in large measure by the success of the tractor. These were tractors that could sit outside for some 20 years and maybe longer, unattended to, that when people got the interest, as it started to perk up by the mid-80s, go out there and decide, well, I don't know, you know, this thing's a 1936 model and we haven't run it since 1959, probably won't do anything, and they fool around with the magneto a little bit and get the engine back free by jiggling the flywheel some, and the next thing you know, it's running again after they've got some of the residue cleaned out of the fuel lines. It's hard to kill an old John Deere tractor.
Right, and while we've been talking, we've been standing in front of this tractor, which of course is one of the most interesting of the, one of the rarest of the two cylinders.
That's right.
Can you tell us a bit about it, Jack?
Well, the Model C tractor preceded the general purpose tractor, the Model GP, and it was the first row crop model that Deere made. It was introduced after 3 years of development in 1928 as the final version that would be marketed. If you look at the serial number on this tractor, located down here on the end of the case, you see that it's 200201. It's the second to the last one built, the last one 200202. The first one, only a month earlier in March of 1928, 200111. Less than 100 of these tractors were built. Less than 10 remain today that are known to exist. They're worth a lot of money. It was the first tractor that went past the $30,000 mark in value. The Model C is different from the GP in a number of features. Would you like me to point out some
yes,
of those?
Please.
Okay. The front axle stop, it goes full width here, all the way across what would have been the cope and drag during the casting process. On the GP, and there's others on the floor here, you'll find that this part of it was gone. It wasn't necessary to have it full width. This is the part that made contact anyhow, usually towards the rear. So it may seem like a small matter, but that much cast iron on each side of the axle was saved. Why not? Here, there's three bolts that hold the engine block in, or three cap screws really on each side. The GP has two. The block comes very close to the frame, actually called the front support. Whereas on the GP, there's kind of a groove here where you could almost get your fingers down into. The exhaust elbow on the C is different from the GP in this manner. If you figure the center line coming down here, it's cut off perpendicular or molded perpendicular to the center line. Whereas on the GP, if you would line up this edge from the flywheel, it comes out and it ends like so, leaving an elliptical opening. Other things that are different, there was no general purpose on top of the hood. Even though this tractor, as restored by the owners, they put the early oiling diagram on the back, that was not on a Model C. The wheel on the Model C is also different in the hub area than that of the GP. The hub is flat all the way across on the C. On the GP tractors, it dips down and then back up, having somewhat of an hourglass shape if you'd look at the cross section of it. The steering wheel is also different. This one has been restored back to the original wood. As you can see, it's a stamped out rim configuration rather than the cast pieces that overlapped on the GP.
John Deere changed the name of this tractor from Model C to GP when salesmen were having difficulty over the phone to customers. This was because the D and the letter C sounded so similar, and so they changed the name to GP or General Purpose. For more detail on the GPs, we went to Eldridge, where we were welcomed by Cork Growth, a specialist in GPs.
Well, hi, fellas. Welcome to Iowa.
Cork's collection is well known, and we looked at two of his tractors, a beautifully restored 1934 version and an earlier tractor which is still awaiting restoration. Tell us a little bit about this one, Cork.
Well, this is a 1934 GP. The 34 GP is a 6-inch bore, and during the evolution of the 6-inch GPs, the cooling was a problem. The radiator was increased about an inch in height, and to keep the fuel from boiling in the fuel tank, there's a heat barrier underneath the fuel tank. And there's a couple of heat shields up here to deflect the heat away from the engine. The later 6-inch bores had a Marvel Shebler carburetor on them instead of an Ensign carburetor.
What's special about the oil system on this one?
The later GPs had a oil filter. The earlier ones did not have this canister here at all. I don't know if you can see the little red stem here, but this is the oil pressure indicator that pops up when the engine is running. On the older GP, that little stem was down here on the main case, and no filtering whatsoever. It was a matter of changing the oil regularly to get the dirt out of the engine.
What about the transmission? Did that alter at all from the early to the later GPs?
Most of the parts in the transmission are the same. They did make a change in the final drive sprocket. They went from 8 teeth to 9 teeth, or vice versa. I can't say for sure. And there was a variety of final drive sprockets available. The parts book indicates some with as low as 19 teeth.
Another difference between the early ones and the later GPs was in the exhaust, wasn't it? The exhaust muffler. Now, this is an early one. What year is this?
This is a 1929.
So that's a pretty good example of
what, the early version inherited straight from the Model C?
That is correct.
Right.
From 28 up until the 6-inch bore in late 31, the exhaust was on the left side and the carburetor mounted in front of the manifold. On the 6-inch bore tractors, the exhaust is on the right side of the tractor and the carburetor mounted across the engine instead of along the engine.
Now, your restored tractor is a 1934, isn't
that's
it?
That's correct.
So that's got the bigger engine and that's got the full modification.
Right.
So can we have a look at that one, please?
Certainly. The exhaust is on the right side of the tractor instead of the left. And this is what they refer to as a spark arrestor muffler. It has a series of louvers on the inside of it to cause the gases to swirl. Another very noticeable difference is the fact that this exhaust system is pointing straight up in the air and it has somewhat of a length to it, where the early one almost curved and pointed down towards the ground. If a hot spark would come out of that exhaust system, they could set the straw fields on fire. And
right.
I guess that did happen.
One of the differences on the old and the later GPs is, you were saying, is the height of the radiator side plate to improve the cooling capacity.
That's correct.
Can we do a measurement on that and see what the difference is?
All right. This part number is C257R, and it measures 17.5 inches high from top of bottom to the core.
Right. Now, can we have a look at the later version?
Sure. Okay, the later version, the part number is C1911R, and it measures 18.75 inches for an inch and a quarter extra height.
Now, apart from being a GP specialist, Cork is also pretty handy at making and mending, and one of the jobs he can do is make carburetors look like new again. This is the way they look when they come in off the farm. And that's the way they can look after they've had the cork treatment. Now, what do you have to do, Cork, to make something that looks like that look like that?
Well, the first job is to completely disassemble it. And I designed and built my own little glass bead blast machine to clean them up. And a lot of these old pot metal tops, when you take the float valves out, they'll break. So I reproduce the top cover plates for them and do all the machine work on them. Frequently the choke levers are broken. I reproduce the choke levers for them. And one of the biggest problems with this type of carburetor, the throttle shaft bushing turns with the throttle shaft. Consequently, when it wears the bore out in the body of the carburetor. So to correct that, I line ream these through the body of the carburetor and make a completely new bushing to fit the newly reamed hole so that I get a good fit. You notice here there's no play or wiggle in this particular throttle shaft. This one here, I don't know if we can see it, but you probably can't see the movement.
Yes,
you can.
It is.
But generally you can shake hands with those throttle shafts. If there's a leak on something of this nature, you get the wrench out and you tighten her up tighter. Well, what happens, they'll bow the mounting flanges of the carburetors. And since this is bronze and not too forgiving if you try to bend them back, I put them in the lathe and take a face cut off the mounting flanges, both the inlet and the discharge end of the carburetor.
Is this the sort of mower they would have used on the GP, Cork?
Yes. In fact, this is the first power mower that John Deere manufactured. As you can see, it's totally integrally mounted, and it runs off the back shaft of the power takeoff unit. It has some features very similar to the number 5 mower. This breakaway gadget here is similar to the number 5, so if you accidentally run the sickle into a fence post, the whole unit will swing back and hinge about a pivot point over here in the corner. I get a lot of comments from people about the wooden block under the seat.
Yes, right.
And the purpose of that is to raise the seat so that the operator didn't have to lift his leg quite so high to be able to press the foot lever down to raise the sickle bar.
So the wooden block would have been available for people using this sort of mower?
That is correct. It is shown in the parts book, and also the little sheet metal bracket that it lands on is part of the mower equipment. As Mike indicated, I do have a few GPs, and since I specialize in them, we came across this pup, and this pup's name is GP. Shake, GP. Come on, shake. Good boy. All right. Right. Okay, you're
now
done.
Now you've been filmed.
Out of the film.
You've had your moment of glory. Another version of the GP is the potato model, which is very rare, and this one is from the Fred Cobbler collection. The serial number of this one, Fred?
Serial number on this particular tractor setting here is 164.
And you've also got another one?
We've got a 165 setting in the barn, and we have another one setting outside that's 168 that's not been restored.
So you've got three of one of the really uncommon tractors. Well, how many of them were built, do you know?
Well, originally there was 202 of these tractors built in late 1929 and 1930.
And where did most of them go?
The tractors was all actually shipped to Syracuse, New York branch house. And quite a few, or almost most of them, ended up in the state of Maine.
Well, that's the big potato growing area.
Yes, the upper part of Maine was large. Now, there was a few got into New York, and they raised potatoes there, and also Pennsylvania.
What makes this a potato model instead of any other model, GP? What are the special features of a potato tractor?
Well, as you know, as you get into this thing, you realize that this was a wide tread metal to start with. The potato people wanted the row width just right on the wheel setting so that they could plant, cultivate, or harvest two rows of potatoes at a time. So therefore, they tucked these quills, as you see here before you, and narrowed these down. On a potato model, they are 17 inches. On a GP wide tread, they are 21 inches. Then you go to a GP standard, and they are less yet.
Right. One of the nice features on this tractor, Fred, is the fact that you've got the cultivator. Now, this would have been the correct cultivator for the potato tractor?
Yes, this cultivator is a original production manufactured implement that went with this tractor. As far as we know, this is the only complete one in the United States.
We've moved to a farm in Ontario, which is big in pigs, big in crops, and very big in two-cylinder tractors. I've moved across to Ingersoll in Ontario to visit the Budd brothers, Don and Howard, and have a look at their collection. It's a pretty big collection, starting with the Waterloo Boy, but one of the special features is their collection of Model A's. Now, this is one of them, Don. Tell us about this one.
Okay, this is our 1934 Model A. It's one of the first Model A's built, 1934 being the first year of production. One of the main features you'll notice on a 34A is the open fan shaft. After 34, where they closed it in, put a tube over top of the shaft to close it in. Probably secondly is the filler holes for the fuel and gas tanks are located right in the center of the hood and directly below the steering rod, and it made it very difficult to fill the tanks. So later, then they moved them off to the side.
Well, and that was the reason, to make the tanks easier to fill. It was more accessible.
Yes, that's correct.
Right.
Probably another feature is the steering wheel on here. You'll find these only on the 34As as well. The other ones, they don't have this cast center coming out like this.
One of the features John Deere introduced on the Model A was being able to alter the track setting on the rear wheels for a row crop work. And this is obviously one of the features of this one.
That's right. Yeah, it makes the tractor very versatile.
Right. And this one's well equipped, I notice, because it's got a lift on it.
Yeah, it has the power lift on here. It's operated by these pedals here. You kick it down to drop your implement down, and then you kick it again to raise it up.
And the other feature on this one, of course, and introduced on the Model A, was the fact that the PTO at the back of the tractor is in the centre line instead of being offset. That must have made life a lot easier for operating implements of one sort.
I would certainly think so. Yeah.
The little red button under the petrol tank, Don, what's that do?
Okay, that's known as a redhead oil pressure indicator pin. The first 2 years, 34 and 35, well, they put that in instead of an oil pressure gauge. So when the engine's running, well, that pin will come up and you know you have oil pressure.
So if the pin doesn't come up, you've got trouble.
Yeah, you better do something about it real fast.
And when the A came out, they improved the transmission, didn't they? They gave more gears. What's the setup?
Okay, we have a high and low range on these tractors, and that gives you two gears in low range and two gears in high range, and still just have the one reverse in low range.
Right. Okay. And there's a bit of comfort for the driver too, because I noticed the seat pan can be adjusted forward and backwards.
That's right. Yeah, they put a handy handle on there, and you can loosen that off and slide it back and carry on.
We've got here three unstyled A's, all made around 1937 to 1938. And they really are very special indeed. This is the AWH, and only 16 of these were made, and that's a very rare tractor. Why AWH? For people who aren't familiar with John Deere, the A stands for the Model A, W is wide,
yes,
front end,
mm-hmm.
And the H is high, so you've got extra clearance.
That's correct.
Right.
Yes.
Okay. So how do you get the extra clearance for a start?
Okay. Well, first of all, they are set a little higher. Your spindles are a little longer. They have 40-inch rear wheels on them. The axles are quite a bit longer than a regular A. Your front axle here has these two blocks in here. There's a short block on that side, and there's a longer block on this side. That'd be for like offsetting on your rows and that type of thing.
From the AWH, we move to the ANH, and this again is very rare because only 17 of them were made. The NH means narrow and high, and these tractors had a single front wheel. Looking from the back here, you get a good impression of the extra ground clearance you've got through having these big wheels and tires. On the axle housing here, the lettering looks a little bit different to on the earlier ones that I've seen of yours. Did that remain the same, or did they alter that at all through the A's?
Well, the earlier A's had the large lettering on the axle, quite a bit larger than what this is on this tractor here.
This is the AW then, Don. Tell us a little bit about this one.
Okay, this is the 37 model. They build around 240 of these.
So this is really rare as well.
Quite rare, yes.
It's obviously wide but not high.
Yeah, the spindles here aren't near as long as on the Highcraft version there.
But is the wheel size the same on the front?
Yes, they're both 16s.
Yeah, right. This is perhaps the most eye-catching of the Model A's in the Bud collection. This is the AOS, Don. Which year was this one?
This was 1937.
Yeah, and that was the first year they were built, wasn't it?
Yes.
And went through till 1940, I think. And it's a pretty unusual tractor. I think they made about 800 of them.
Mm-hmm.
It's basically a standard Model A with some trimmings on, right?
Well, there are some other differences. Like, it's narrower, the crank is shorter. The front axle, it's different on it. Yeah, they're quite a bit more compact than a regular, like say an AR.
Well, they narrowed it down as well as streamlining it.
Mm-hmm.
Also, they've taken the exhaust stack away.
Yeah, they mounted that under the hood there,
yep,
right?
Tucked that away.
And then they put that pointed front end on. It was the only model John Deere built with that pointed front.
And it's, yeah, it looks pretty distinctive too.
Yeah, it really sets it apart from many of the other versions.
This one came out of the States, I gather. Was it in fairly good condition when you bought it?
This is just the way we bought it, just over a year ago.
Right.
Come from Illinois.
I think it's a great tractor. It's I think the Orchard series right the way through from John Deere was, they look really distinctive, and this is probably the most distinctive of the lot.
We sure like it anyway.
We've moved on to something completely different. Tell us about it, Don.
Okay, this is the 1952 A high crop, Mike.
So that's the last production year.
That's right.
Right, we span the whole production series of the Model A.
Yes. Okay. This tractor runs on straight gas, as compared to the other one, start on gas and turn it over to kerosene or distillate or whatever. This tractor came from California. It was a very high clearance tractor, built for specialty crops, bushy crops and that.
They made a lot of changes in the Model A during the production period, didn't they? What are some of the improvements on this one, Don?
Well, certainly one major change is the increase in horsepower. They gradually increased that as production went on. We got electric start on this tractor as compared to the flywheel hand start.
Do they alter the gearbox at all?
Yeah, this tractor here just has the one 6-speed case. You don't have to shift high to low.
So there's no high-low. And they've altered the wheel sizes too to get the clearance. What size have we got on the front?
That's right. These are 20s on the front of the high crop here.
And on the back wheels?
And on the back is 38.
And the drive to the back wheels, that's been completely redesigned as well.
That's right. There's a drop case goes down from your main axle on down to drive your wheel, and it's chain driven down there.
Right. And that's how you get the high clearance at the back.
That's right. Keeps your tractor up good and high.
What we got here in the early A and the late A is a pretty good example of the way the styling changed on John Deere tractors. You fill us in a bit on that, Don.
Towards the end of 1938, they hired a fellow by the name of Henry Dreyfuss to come up with a more streamlined and stylish look to the tractors. So that's when they switched the A's and the B's. They started with them and came up with this styling here. It certainly made the tractors look very attractive.
In Drayton, Ontario, Don Morden showed me the meaning of horsepower in years gone by. Now, this is the sort of horsepower that John Deere helped to put out of business. And these are your horses, Don. Tell us a bit about them. What breed are they?
Well, they're Belgian. They're about 6 years old. I bought them as yearlings.
Is it easy for you to get enough work for them, Don?
In the spring, in the syrup time, I give them a pretty good workout. I have 1,300 taps. They're all picked up from buckets hanging on the trees, and this team does most of it.
Yeah.
But during the year, I rent them out to the Mennonites, who live not too far away, and they work them on binders and cutting hay and that kind of thing.
And the wagon, which is really why we're here, is painted green. It's got John Deere on the side. This is something that John Deere used to make as well.
Apparently, they made a lot of them. In the out west, in the big thrashing bees out there, they'd have a fleet of these things hauling grain away from the separator and wherever they went to dump it. And John Deere was in the market too. They were making them too.
This is Alex Smith's trailer. Do you happen to know how long he's had it?
Alec has just purchased this in the last year.
Right.
Yeah, he brought it up from Nebraska.
But it'd be pretty old. Any idea when it would have been made?
Well, we kind of think in the 1920s and around that area sometime. But
so it really is pretty old. And was it in good condition when he got it?
Just like this.
Really?
Yeah.
So it had been kept undercover?
Yeah. The wood's good. There's no rot on it or anything. And
it's pretty good. It looks very smart.
After sampling the leisurely pace of life with Don's Belgian horses, we have another view of the past with a tractor collection beside a restored windmill in East Anglia.
We've come to Thelneatham in Suffolk, which is not very far from where I live, to have a look at some Model B tractors. They're part of the collection of belonging to Brian Davey. He's got more than 50 tractors of one sort and another. And the collection includes this very nice BR, which I think is one of the early ones. It's an unstyled tractor. What year is this one then, Brian?
1936.
So that is quite one of the early ones.
One of the early ones, yes.
And you've also got one of the slightly later ones, and it happens to be a BR, and that's one across there. That's the Orchard version. Brian, tell us what the differences are between this early BR model and the slightly later one.
The main difference is the compression taps. This one doesn't have any, where the later one does. This one is slightly smaller engine, and it doesn't need compression taps to start it, where the later one has compression taps, and you open the cocks to start it. Makes the starting easier.
Well, what other differences were there between the two?
The radiator shutters were different. This model has the earlier type of pull down curtain radiator shutter.
Right.
Now, this is the BU, and this has the later type of radiator shutters that are worked by this lever from the driver's seat.
And levers here?
The levers, and the whole front thing moves in sections and shuts the air off.
Closes the shutters.
That's right.
Now, this is the Orchard model. What are the features on it which show us an Orchard tractor?
Well, the BR has the upright air stack, where the BU has the enclosed air stack under here. It also has these flutes, which would push the branches away from the tops, so it didn't damage the tractor and the branches. It also could have had full citrus fenders. If it was a groove model, they had citrus fenders which would come completely down to here, and this would all be shielded in right across to here. Another main difference is that the BU has independent turning brakes for more manoeuvrability.
Well, for getting in amongst the trees?
Yeah, that's right. Right.
So you've got a brake pedal for each wheel, in
fact?
For each
wheel, yes, where the BR doesn't have that.
Right.
This is the John Deere number 4 mower. With a 5-foot cut, it takes its drive from the gearbox here. It also has the quick release hitch that will come undone if you hit anything with the end of the cutter bar.
Right. One of the features I like on this mower is the seat. If you look closely, you can see not only the John Deere name, but also the John Deere emblem. It's a nice touch, isn't it?
It is, yeah, very nice.
This is another Model B, but it looks very different to Brian Davies' tractor in England. This is the track-laying version of the Model B, and it's generally known as the Lindemann Crawler.
We're in Iowa on a blazing hot day, just outside a little town called Ollie, and this is Harold Schultz, and this is his Model B Lindemann Crawler. When was this one made, Harold?
In August of 44. They're calling it a 45 model.
And it's basically, it's an Orchard model, isn't it? It's a BR.
Right, they were all Orchard, made for the Northwest, for the orchards out there.
And what was the background to the tie-up with the Lindemann brothers?
Well, Deere didn't have a small crawler. Cat was the only one that had a small crawler, and they wanted a small crawler for the Orchard. And so Deere sent a BO wheel tractor out to the Lindemann brothers in Yakima, Washington. And they took the wheels off and made this track conversion for it out there.
And that was when? When did they start off with this?
Well, they started in 39 and 40 was when they were doing it, but then they didn't come out till about probably late 40.
They'd done a few GPs previously.
Right,
hadn't
they did.
It was very few.
Yeah, only about two dozen of them, you know, 24 or five.
And this was a real success story, wasn't it?
Well, they got the most, turned out the most. Yeah. Lindemann people say 1,675 produced.
And it's what brought Lindemann and Deere together in what
right.
was quite a long relationship, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Yes, it was.
Because
the MC was eventually started out there, see,
that's
the
right.
crawler that followed this.
And in fact, Deere took over Lindemann.
Right, they bought them out there in 47 when they ceased on this one, see.
Right. One of the unusual features on this tractor is the pads you've got on the tracks. Now, where did that idea come from?
These are really pads that were really built for the MC. I can pull it on concrete or grass and not tear it up.
The other feature on this tractor, obviously, is the fact that you've got the blade on and the full hydraulics.
Right.
Now, this is a Lindemann blade? With the
right, it's a Lindemann blade, and it can be reversed on this and used as a toolbar across the back, too.
Right.
This same, take the blade off, see, and I also have that, and I'm going to put it on coming up soon.
And that was equipment that was available
for
the Lindemann.
Right.
Right.
Well, this wrench here, that's what holds the blade on there. You just pull that out of there, and this here will just come out of there, say, like so.
And that, and where does the wrench fit? It's obviously designed to fit on there.
Yeah, one of them does. I don't know if it's this one here or not. Yeah.
That's neat, isn't it?
Yeah. And you can take that bracket off there that way. And then the other size is, I think there are two different sizes, you know.
Green and yellow are the standard colors for Deere farm tractors, with yellow for the industrial models, but there were some exceptions. The red paint finish on this Model B was specially requested when the Waterloo municipality ordered the tractor originally. We followed the highway past thousands of acres of rich farmland to find a styled Model G. Most of our two-cylinder tractors were filmed on farms, but the Model G was parked in a suburban back garden under its sun umbrella. John Deere introduced the Model G in 1938, and it was then an unstyled tractor, and it was styled a couple of years later, and this is a styled version we've got here. It belongs to Steve Barron from Hiawatha, Iowa. And Steve, when was this one made? It's one of the late ones?
It was shipped February 21st of 1952, and the serial number is 59,729, so it would be to the end of the line. 1953 was the end of them, with the serial number of 64,400.
So this really was a late one?
Yes.
Yep, fine. And when it was introduced, it was right up at the top end of the market as far as John Deere was concerned. I mean, the power output, it was a big tractor from its day.
Yes, it was the largest row crop they had available, and it was a three-bottom plow tractor.
Yours has got an umbrella on it, and I'm intrigued by that because it's something we never see in England. Do you often get them over here?
Yes, before the cab tractors come out in this territory, we use these tractors, row crop tractors, a lot to cultivate with and do hay work, and it's quite cool under that umbrella. And I had this one rebuilt from scratch. It's a new one, had a silk screen, just like the old stencil was.
So it's very much like you might have had an umbrella fitted when the tractor was new.
Oh, yes.
Apart from the umbrella, of course, this is a pretty well-equipped tractor generally. This hydraulic cylinder, I'm not familiar with that. What did that do?
That was an option that raised and lowered your implements, like your plows, discs, and so forth. This is the way it came from the factory, without hoses. Anytime you got a new tractor, normally, if you ordered it with a cylinder, it would just come on there without hoses. And then depending on the implement you had, how long the hoses you needed, the dealer would fit the hoses to fit your implement.
It's got power troll as well. This is, again, obviously to do with the hydraulics. What did it do?
The power troll operated your hydraulic cylinder here. There's valves in there, and that's what made your oil flow back to raise and lower your implements.
And this foxes me completely because I'm not too familiar with that.
Yeah, that's a PTO cover shield, so that for another safety feature they had, if you had to take this off for installing some of your implements, you still had another cover that went over the PTO shaft for safety.
So we're beginning to think about safety and comfort for the driver, because I see we've got a step for climbing aboard here and a padded seat with a padded seat back. Another feature for the driver, I think, is this roll-o-matic system. How did this work, Steve?
Each wheel oscillated individually, so if you hit a clod with the one wheel, it'd go up, another one would go down. It'd take a lot of the shock out of the steering, and it'd operate a lot like power steering because it made it so much easier to steer.
Apart from his full-size Model G tractor, Steve has an amazing collection of John Deere model tractors, badges, pictures, and all sorts of other memorabilia, all neatly displayed in his basement museum. Well, we've seen just the start of the John Deere two-cylinder tractor story, and there's much more to come, covering the start of the numbered models and the early days of John Deere diesel power. It's all in the next part of our two-cylinder tractor story called John Deere on Video Volume 2.